So we're really lucky to have Dr. Forrest with us today. Catherine came to Santa Cruz in 1994 and has had many different roles in our community. Let's see, I'm not sure I can name them all. You want to name them all?
Let's see, I started at the county clinics in the as part of the care team doing HIV care. And I was there for a number of years, and then I became the medical director of the Santa Cruz Women's Health Center. So some of you know me from my hat there for a number of years. Back to the county clinics, up to UCSC for a short while. And so I was on many of the founding committees as the Central Coast Alliance for Health and then Central California Alliance for Health, so the Hepatitis C Task Force, the initial Physicians Advisory Committee, a lot of those initial founding groups. But I had this crazy idea about 8 years ago that there aren't enough primary care doctors, and re-entered academia. So I've been first at UCSF for 4 years and then for the last 3 years at Stanford. So it's in the context of my education hat that I'm here today.
Yeah, it's perfect. And Catherine and I celebrated our 30th anniversary this year. Yeah.
We met the first day of med school.
First day of med school we met. Yeah, good. So I'm really totally honored to have you talk today, and this is such important work, and we have a guest surprise. So thank you so much, Catherine, for everything.
Thank you so much. The other hat that I wear is I'm on the California Academy of Family Physicians Legislative Affairs Committee, which I've been for over 15 years. I strongly believe that one of the roles of being in primary care is to try and see if we can push forward advocacy for our patients and for ourselves. And this particular place, Pajaro Dunes, is a special place for me. It's the last place I came as in a family reunion with my family before my mother died when she was for her 75th birthday. So if I'm a little quavery, it's because one of the reasons I worked on this bill so hard was there was a bill in the legislature when she was first diagnosed with her cancer, which ultimately she died from about 8 years ago. About 2 weeks ago, actually, 2 weeks apart from Jen's mother, actually, another reason we're bonded forever. She would have used this option if it was available to her. She had incredible medical care, exquisite palliative care. She was in the clinical trials. She's the daughter of two physicians. My grandmother was the first woman chief of a medical staff in the US in 1975. And she strongly believed in the science of trying to figure out how to change and push forward treatment. But when the time came she wanted to go home and die, she was in hospice for a couple of weeks, beautifully cared for. But she would have chosen a different way had it been possible for her. When Senator Monning first was approached this issue with the care and thoughtfulness that he does everything related to health and welfare of our state's populations, thank you for that. I was on board. And I'll go through the End of Life Option Act as it was passed, and it's with that love and caring for close people to me, and also all my patients, starting from when I was first an AIDS doctor back in the 80s when I first started training, when people would come to me and ask me, will you, that I carry each and everyone in my heart, that I know that there's some people that this option is the right option for. Only some. We know from other states' experiences that it's not for all. Just like so many things, it turns out that not everything is for everybody. I have no disclosures other than that I'm a human being. Currently, I teach in the School of Medicine at Stanford. I'm the medical director of Stanford's community primary care at Los Altos. The picture there is taken by my son, Owen Forrest, who is an aspiring photographer, and it's Machu Picchu, which is my mother's favorite place on Earth. I went there last summer with my family. The objectives today is to know the basic requirements of the End of Life Option Act. I misspelled it there, it's Option Act. Everyone knows that there's multiple options, but you'll see that many of us make that mistake from time to time. I'm gonna try and show you some examples of how it's played out in Oregon, where the bill has been, where it's been implemented almost 20 years ago, in Washington, about over a decade, and then learned some things about compassionate patient-centered responses to requests for aid in dying. Keep in mind that the conversations we had this morning were derived from a state that does not have this option amongst its options yet. In my day, people died. And when was that? You heard this morning from Michael that actually the demographics of when people died have changed dramatically over the last 100 plus years. At the beginning of the last century, the average age of death was under 50. By the time the end of the Second World War, it was about 60. In 1970, it was 70. At the end of the millennium, it was just under 80. It's now over 80. So you can see that actually people died, as Michael said, suddenly earlier, in the beginning of the birth of your grandparents, but also slower. The picture on the top is actually bedside in the ICU at Stanford. I want to spend just a second talking about the words that we use currently. The current language is aid in dying. It's gone from physician aid in dying now to medical aid in dying, and that's partly because we know that in some states, even though in our state that only physicians are authorized under our law to write a prescription, that there are some states where that will be changing or may change. So, but the words aid in dying are currently the term adopted by most laws and professional societies for when a physician or clinician prescribes a lethal dose of a medication to a mentally competent, terminally ill individual upon the patient's request, where the patient intends to hasten the end of their life. Keep in mind that competency has its base in other things that we do for competency, like are they competent to decide about treatments like life-prolonging treatments, for instance, cancer treatments or surgery. Competency is defined in the medical lexicon. The American Public Association clarified, and other organizations such as the American Psychiatry Association have followed suit, that the reasoning on which a terminally ill person whose judgments are not impaired by mental disorders bases a decision to end his or her life is fundamentally different than the reasoning that someone who is a clinically depressed uses to justify suicide. This is not suicide. And then when you look at the other words that are used in the literature, euthanasia is specifically a third party administering lethal dose of a medication, and it's an individual to end their suffering. It's illegal in every state in the United States. It is legal in some countries in Europe, but it is illegal in our country. And then physician-assisted suicide is considered archaic today. It's still purposely used by some groups that are opponents to it, but it's not really used in professional organizations for the most part because of the definition of suicide that's recognized by the psychiatrists, psychologists, and people in public health and medical organizations. This slide is to show you the interesting times that we live in. The blue slides are the ones that currently have laws passed that legalize aid in dying. Our own state, California, Oregon, Washington, and Vermont. The light blue state up there at the top, Montana, was done by legalization by court decision. And then those pink states are states considering death with dignity in this year's session. So for instance, Washington, D.C. Is currently very close along, and there's others that are very moving along the state legislature pass. We'll talk a little bit more about that in a while, but about half the states and almost half of the state's population, the nation's populations, are in the move for state movement on this. It looks a little bit like a little bit in marriage equality, if there's a little bit of a national move to change things at a state level, even though their passage has been only in four states so far. I wanted to spend just a time to look at who is using the option in the states that have been around for a while. So this data is derived from the Oregon Public Health Division from 2015. We can see Oregon is a much more homogeneous state than our state, but even so, Oregon has 77% of its population is white, but even so, 95% of the people who use the option are white. So it's heavily weighted towards uses by people who are defined as white, a small population, 12%. Only 9 patients Asian, 6 Hispanic, 1 black. So you can see it's heavily weighted towards a white population. For the most part, the people that use the option have cancer. And it breaks down by what kind of cancer. Largely lung cancer, some with breast, colon, pancreatic, et cetera. A small proportion with ALS. The Neurologic Association has been able to break down prognosis, so people that have ALS, there's a window where their prognosis fits the definition of the law, and they are still able to self-administer. We'll talk a little bit more about the requirements of the law in a second. And then the reasons for using the option. Most people are worried about losing their autonomy or not being able to engage in activities that make their life enjoyable. It's not things that you might have thought that it was. For instance, some state the other things that they have loss of quote unquote dignity or how they define dignity for themselves or loss of body functions. Low on the list was financial implication of treatment. That was less than 5%. Washington shows something similar. This is a very dense slide, but it shows pretty much the same thing. So in the Washington data for last year, 98% were white, non-Hispanic. Most were married. 75%, by the way, are college educated. That's the same in Oregon. Heavily weighted towards people that are white, educated, male, privileged. So let's spend just a second to look about California's law and why it's different and looks to accommodate the diversity of our community. One thing that's different is that it carefully looks to protect both those who are participating and not participating carefully. So this is the language that a healthcare provider will not be subject to civil, criminal, administrative, disciplinary, employment, credentialing, professional, contractual liability, medical staff action, sanction, penalty, or liability for participating. I put all of those words in there, and I won't repeat them, just to mark the care taken to protect people that choose in a time of changing practice to step across what has been a line that hasn't been stepped before. And then the same thing for declining to participate. For so people who choose to opt out or for whatever reasons, and it can be their own reasons to not participate, the same protection is afforded for individuals. This is really important because what we've seen so far in implementation is that people are unsure where they fall. This is a radical scope of practice change for many people. It's not unlike, by the way, the change when abortion became legal in 1973, where all of a sudden people had to sort of figure out where they stood on the continuum of decisions of something that had been illegal and could get your license taken away or worse. But you're protected under this law. Similarly, organizations are protected. Organizations are protected from participating under good faith. And if they decide that they are going to be a non-participatory organization, they can prohibit their employees, independent contractors, or others from participating under premises owned or managed. It does not mean that they can't communicate in the same way that you can't communicate the law, but they can't participate and prescribe, etc. This has not been tested yet. And I know in the community here and in the community on my side that there's varying degrees of non-participation. So in some institutions, non-participation means we're not going to talk about this and you can't talk about this either. And no one has brought that forward. And in some, it's been a little looser, like we're not writing prescriptions here, but if you want to refer to someone who's outside this institution, you may. Just the way that you might do today for something like a vasectomy, for instance. If the organization is not prohibiting, then they must give notice. In other words, the people who are taken care of by that organization must know that that organization is an opt-out organization. Some of you may have seen in the paper, in the months immediately following the passage, there was this sort of flurry of who's gonna opt out? Are we gonna opt out? Are they gonna opt out? And it's really settled down now to very few opt out. Most organizations are letting their clinicians or their physicians decide, with the exception of the Catholic institutions, all of whom which are opt-out. Went into effect June 9th. It has a built-in sunset of 10 years. It's based very closely on the Oregon Death with Dignity, which is almost 20 years. As I mentioned, it has some key things in it that provide some additional protection for both providers and also for patients. And we don't know how many people have used the option or have brought it up yet, because the data will not be released until next summer. Anecdotally, my institution, we've had under 10 that we know of that have used it, but we know that there have been a lot of conversations, and I know from your community that there's been a lot of conversations and consultations as well. So this is just two county, two systems, so we think that it's been talked about quite a bit more, and I think that Senator Monning will talk a little bit more about that. So I'm going to spend some time actually going into granular detail. As I've given this talk, I've gotten deeper and deeper into what I believe is the right thing to do, which is to open the door and share, how is this done? What do we do? What is the gasp checklist? And I've developed a checklist for my organization, because as it turns out, when people are anxious, they forget steps, and our patients are anxious as well. They want to know, what do you know? And we want to know, what do I need to know? And so it's with that in mind that I'm going to take you through, what do you do? What do we do? And for those of you that are in systems that are opt out, what will happen when my patient leaves me? Because I can tell you, I've yet to meet someone that doesn't care deeply about that. We all care about what happens to the people around us. So to request a prescription, the patient must be at least 18, a California resident, and this law spells out what that means. It means a driver's license. It means that you have an address in the state, that you're paying bills. It's very similar to other things that require in our country, in our state residency, that they're mentally competent to make and communicate healthcare decisions. This is important. Competency is the role of the attending physician and the consulting physician. Both have to determine competency. If you don't feel that they can make a decision to do this, or get surgery, or get chemotherapy, you're done. This is not an option. If they are, you go forward. They're diagnosed with a terminal disease that has a reasonably predicted to result in death within 6 months. This is a tricky part. I was happy to know that there's actually some other tools, because those of us in primary care are dealing with this all the time for hospice. Like, is it 6 months? Is it 6 months? And I can tell you right now, if it's longer than 6 months, for the most part, people throw up their hands and are thrilled. Most of the people in Oregon and Washington push out the use till way closer than 6 months. The data shows that people aren't using this like way, way, way ahead in advance. The usage is actually closer. People want as much time as they can. So that's the good news. The bad news is that everyone's anxious about this piece, the responsibility of it. We do the best we can. The last one is able to ingest the medication independently. So you can't have someone pour it down your throat. You have to be able to ingest the medication independently. And it cannot be done by someone else tipping it into your mouth or deciding for you. So it cannot be used, for instance, by someone with dementia. Competency, ability. So the patient will be prescribed if they meet these things. So here's the beginning of the checklist, and I'm going to bring you through each of these things. Two verbal requests, a written request, the forms must be used, specific forms, a prescribing doctor and another doctor, and then they're competent, and the diagnosis and prescription. So here we go. Hold on to your seats. The patient has, and then also the patient could have a psychological examination if anyone decides that there's any possibility that the person's not able to make the decision. The prior prescribing, you have to decide that they're not being coerced, another element to it. The law does require you to talk about alternatives, and the law requires the patient to notify their next of kin, but you can't require them to notify them. So you're asked to say that it would be a good idea, but not to require them. And then you offer the patient the opportunity to rescind. And there's a moment in
the checklist, if that makes sense, and I'll run you through this, okay? So here we go, summary. The last things, if you do, this is a, I added this because somebody asked me this question. If the person is given the medication by another person, that's actually a felony in the law. This is a protection for patients. No other person can make requests for you. That's also not allowed under the law. And I include the full text so that you could read it. So remember I said that there are a few differences between our law and the Oregon law. These are protections for patients to make sure that there's not coercion that's involved. So here we go. Our documentation requires us to keep copies of everything that we submit to the state as well. So here we go. Patients made your request. And I realized that actually this is the moment that is a unique opportunity to do what we learned this morning, isn't it? It really is. This is an ask for you to have that conversation. I'm going to revise my slide now, as I learned something this morning, which is this is the moment to go to a crucial conversation, isn't it? Because you need more information. You need to know why, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that, but I'm going to revise the slide that this is the opening for crucial conversation to find out what's behind that request. But we're going to fast forward a little bit to, is this a true request for the purposes of this? So just put into your head, the patient requests, and then maybe that's a moment to get into crucial conversation. Go to one of the resources, do they meet the criteria? And then this is an important moment, are you willing? So most of the people in this room may have considered this question. If you're a physician, are you willing to be a prescriber? Could you be a prescriber? If the answer is yes and yes, then you could go further. If the answer is yes, I am willing, and no, I can't because of where I work, what is my workaround? If the answer is no, and I can't talk about this, what are you going to do for your patient? How are you going to respond? So what is your response in this situation? This is really worth spending some personal time on. Really evaluate for yourself. There is, at the end-of-life option, endoflife.org is one place that you could have your patients go to see what their options are. That is one site. Then the last thing is that we're recommending a referral to hospice for everyone who's looking at end-of-life option. Regardless of whether or not they're going to pursue the medication. If you've answered that question for yourself, the data shows us, and it's been well laid out for you by both Michael and by Rochelle, that people who are referred into palliative care and hospice do better. So if you've arrived there, that this patient is, whether or not they're going to use end-of-life option or medical aid in dying, think about a hospice referral right now. This is the mandated form that you use. It's on the website, and I have the link for that on your resources here in your handbook. And you're part in the form. This you keep a copy of, and then you send the rest to the state's Department of Public Health. It must be witnessed, and it can be witnessed. Only one of the people can be in your clinic, only one of the people can be related by blood, and they cannot benefit from the person's death. And only one of the people can be working at the healthcare facility. So if you're gonna do it, make sure the person comes with a family member or someone who can be the witness.
Can you say that again? It has to be a family member who has no financial...
They can't stand to benefit from the person's death.
Okay, so no one who's in any kind of trust or will?
Clarification, there can be a family member who is, but the third person has to be not related and can't have a financial relationship. I was misleading. Let me rephrase that. So the family member can have a financial relationship, but the third party cannot be a family member and cannot have a financial relationship. So that could be someone from the clinic, for instance. Yes, I'm sorry, I wasn't clear. Thank you for clarifying.
If you belong to an organization that's opted out of this, our best choice then is to refer to hospice and then turned the care over to the hospice medical director?
You're raising an interesting point, which is, do we have a system for finding physicians who are opt-in in our community? And what we know from Oregon and Washington is it took about 2 years for the informal networks to find someone who would be a prescribing physician in the community, in various communities, faster in some communities and slower in others, because there's no registry. There's no planned EOL.org site. We don't have a network yet of providers, and it's a problem in many communities. It's a problem in the silos of organizations and in communities. So right now, I have no way of, in my own community, of refining who else is prescribing in my community. And it might be something that Santa Cruz County and Monterey County do, which is to figure out how to informally or formally refer. It's difficult. As I said, it's very similar to early abortion, if you think about it. Who is willing to say that they do this? And the answer to that is complicated. So, for instance, I've stepped out and said, I'm willing to do this, and it's complicated in my medical community. I practice at a place that basically doesn't say death or dying. And I practice to support my patients. I'm not pro-death, I'm pro-patient. Do you hear the difference? So, I really respect and admire every person's choice on this, but I think it's very difficult to step forward in a time of social change. I'm gonna take a few more questions. I'm gonna go through to see if I answer your questions, and then I'll take more questions. I wanna be respectful of my other speakers' times, and perhaps I'll answer your questions, so hang on to them for a second. So you're gonna document your conversation in your chart. You're gonna include it in your problem list, wherever it is. Under Medicare, there is an end-of-life planning codes now in documentation in the ICD-10. So use it, code for it, get paid for it if you're using Medicare. There will be some in Medicaid and in capitation. There's systems as well. You'll become familiar with those. And then schedule the visit for over 15 days. The law requires 15 days between the first and the second requests, and the patient needs witnesses at the next visit too. Okay? So this sort of tells you how to go about that. And if the patient requires that all of this occur in the language that they speak. So one of the big differences in our state, of course, is that many of our patients may not speak English. For instance, where I practice, about half my patients speak other languages. They may be educated, but I regularly use Farsi, Arabic, Korean, Japanese, because I work practice in Silicon Valley. I practice on the peninsula. It may be that in this community you can conduct yourselves in Spanish, but there are other languages as well. So if you do use an interpreter, you're required to use the interpreter form as well. Okay? Again, place the hospice referral then. And then think about that psychiatry referral if it's possible in the community, and if you have any question marks, this is one to be really clear on, that you want to make sure that if the person has some underlying issue going on that you're addressing it, if it's possible. In that 15-day waiting period, you're going to do all this other stuff. I recommend that you download your forms, that you look about consultation for medications. It took me months to do this, but I've included in your packet my recommendations for medications. This is from this page here that says Death with Dignity, includes the current medications that are used in Washington and Oregon. When we first rolled out, the recommendation was Seconal, which some of you may know went up in price. It looks a little bit like EpiPen applied to the Medicare population. It went over $4,000. The current recommendation, which is propranolol, diazepam, and morphine, is about $250, and it's shown to be faster and effective. So
have the conversations. That guideline also has some counseling for what to say to patients and their families. How are you going to, what's going to happen to you? How to prepare the medications? I'm not going to go over it in detail, but I'm always happy to talk to anybody about this, and I'm making it available to pharmacists as well. You need to identify the pharmacy. We've identified some in our area. I know that you have pharmacies in your area that will be willing to prescribe, to make the medications available, and we can talk a little bit more about that. One of the same problems with, we have the same problem with pharmacies as we have with physicians, is people are concerned about stepping forward. Again, for those of you who were in the Plan B trial in the 1990s, getting the first person to come forward was quite a challenge. Thank you, Westside Pharmacy. So then the next steps, you're gonna, again, download your forms. There is a final attestation form that's required from the patients as well. These are in checklist form, so you can just go click, 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 click. Again, my slides will be on the website for you to be able to go through them. And then if they want to proceed, you go ahead and refer them. This is the written instructions. This is also on that paper, so I'm not going to spend time on it. But it does include things like don't do this in a public place, have someone else present. I'm strongly recommending that the hospice team be involved and understand. If they're in a Catholic hospice system, Catholic hospice is not participating, but I can tell you they want to know. And then afterwards, you fill out the attending visit note and finish the checklist for the state. Send that into the California Department of Public Health. If they want to proceed, the question earlier was, when do you write the prescription? It's at 48 hours. So we know that you've already informed the pharmacy 2 weeks ahead of time, if you can, so they can get the medication. But the drugs are not hanging around at the family's house. It's about 48 hours before. You let the family know this is lethal, by definition, should be locked and kept safe. Oh, one other thing is that the cause of death by law is the underlying disease. It is not medical aid in dying. So just like when someone decides to go off respirator, the cause of death is not you went off the respirator. You list the cause of death. This is exactly the same. So if you're right on the death certificate, the cause of death is the cancer or the ALS. And also, it is not a coroner's case by law. It's not a coroner's case. Okay? At least he died at home. After the death, preferably you debrief if you can. It really helps people in the grieving process. There's a form. I'm reiterating, not a coroner's case. The cause of death is written as the underlying terminal disease. And then there's a series of forms that you fill out. I'm strongly recommending that people talk with their peers. This is a first. The first time you do this care, it's a first. And I think that it helps to communicate with your peers and your team what's happening for you as well as for your patients. I did want to spend just a second talking about something that's increasing in our community, which is voluntarily stopping of eating and drinking. I won't spend a long time on this, but this is protected under law as well. It's the same as refusing medical treatment for a terminal patient. And we're seeing a big upswing in our community. You may be seeing it here as well. It takes a little less time than going through the procedure of end of life. It requires some things in place, specifically talking with a physician, asking them if they would provide a sedative for you, making sure an advanced directive is in place, making sure a pulse is in place, and advising them about what it would be like. They're seeing a big rise in this in Oregon and Washington as well, and I didn't want to leave this talk without at least highlighting it, that it's covered in the law similarly, or in case law similarly to end of life option, and we're seeing a big increase in my community. I suspect you will here too, because it's less cumbersome. I'm really encouraging people, if you haven't done so yourself, to do your own end of life plan. It's really a good process. Five wishes, DPA for healthcare,
go through the process, it's really hard to advise other people if you haven't done it yourself. I had my kids do it. That was really a riot, let me tell you. They have some ideas. So this is in your handout too, the 7 steps to responding to aid in dying. I'm really going to change this one to clarify the request. I think that's a lean in. That's an opening for a crucial conversation. So next time I give this talk, I'm going to point to Dr. Bernanke. I think it's interesting that we have our options are different and the conversations are coming differently because of the public debate in our state. Affirm your commitment, address root causes, and then the root causes may be something different than you think. It might be fear of pain, fear of being left alone. It's really an opportunity to open and ask these deep questions. We're used to this tell, ask, tell model. Let me tell you what's going to happen to you. And I'm really in that same crucial conversation, ask, tell, ask. What do you understand about your situation? Or in the language of our thing, what is your understanding of your where you are now in your disease process? What are you hoping for? What matters to you? One question that we've used in our setting is, what can we do to best help you live the life you want to live in the time that you have? A really clarifying question, and to help understand what's important to people. They may want to feel good and do things rather than feel bad and be involved in a clinical trial. So this, again, we've gone over these. It's good to remind yourselves that combinations and sequential work. So the comic says, just so you know, I never want to live in a vegetative state dependent on some machine. If that ever happens, just unplug me, okay? And then, click. Here's reference to the doc-to-doc consultation line that we talked about. This is Compassion and Choices put this together. It's to mentor through if you have a case or you have a question, the hotline, and then the pharmacist to pharmacist. Again, these resources are in your packet. So I'm very honored to share this stage with Senate Majority Leader Bill Monning. We've shared the stage a few times before, and it's been my pleasure to introduce him and for him to talk a little bit about what the implementation has been and what we can look forward to for support in the future.
Let's think. Well, it's a great honor to join you. I want to thank Catherine for sharing her time with me. And to thank all of you for being here and the organizers of this very important conversation. We would not have passed this law in California without the active involvement of members of the physicians community, like Dr. Sonquist Forrest, like the CMA, and other organizations that I'll reference briefly. I think it's fair to say that the End of Life Options Act in California, this is the actual text, is the most thorough law of its kind in the country and probably in the world. We did pattern much of it after the Oregon law. We learned a lot from physicians in Oregon, from hospice providers in Oregon and others, but we adapted it to California. Catherine mentioned we incorporated mandatory interpretation for non-native English speaking. Anyone who talks with a doctor using an interpreter or in a non-English language, then the forms have to be interpreted for that patient from English into that target language. Some other protections, it's full of protections. And one thing we did often when we pass a law in Sacramento, it then goes to the appropriate agency to put into regulations. In this case, it would have been the Department of Health, Public Health in California. To save time and to make sure that we incorporated concerns of physicians, this piece of legislation has all the forms in it. We didn't wait for regulations to be promulgated. So when this was signed into law and when it became law, it has all the forms in it that Catherine mentioned. The pathway, and I won't have time to go through all of the steps, but this was first brought to my office by members of a group called the Senior Legislature of California, a nonpartisan organization of seniors. They meet in Sacramento when we're on recess, and they come up with recommendations for legislative ideas that are of great importance to the senior community. And in 2013, 2014, this was their number one priority. They brought it to us, they wanted us to introduce it in 2014. We knew of the past history in California. In the mid-90s, it failed to make it out of the state assembly. And at that time, there was opposition from the California Medical Association and others. So the homework assignment we gave ourselves was, look, we're in the end of a two-year session in 2014. We'll be starting a two-year session January of 2015. Let's use 2014 to do outreach. Let's try to engage the physician community and other known opponents, including the Catholic Church. And so when we introduced the bill, my co-author is Senator Lois Wolk, who's just termed out of office, and a colleague in the Assembly, Assemblymember Susan Eggman, who had been a hospice worker in Oregon. And in our approach, we reached out to not only people we knew would be allies, but people we knew had been historic opponents, like CMA, like the Catholic Church. We met with Bishop Gomez from Los Angeles. We said, look, we're not trying to change church doctrine or faith doctrine, but as we move forward, if you have thoughts or concerns that we haven't addressed, we're willing to listen. And that doesn't mean that you're gonna endorse it at any step of the way. The same outreach to Disability Rights California. Disability groups were on different sides of this. Some felt that people with disabilities might be taken advantage of. Others felt that people living with disabilities should be afforded the same rights of all other Californians, including if they ended up with a terminal illness, the opportunity to consider an end-of-life option act. Another guiding philosophy as we move forward was to use this bill to expand awareness of hospice, of palliative care, and that we weren't pushing something that was instead of, but rather to enhance people's awareness of the continuum of healthcare options. And we also used the language along the way that this is for a very limited universe of people within a limited universe of people. In other words, the limited universe are people with a terminal illness with less than 6 months to live. And within that universe, only a certain number or percentage for whom this would be a viable potential option to consider. What we know from Oregon over about 20 years, just over 50% of those who qualified for the prescription and obtained the prescription ended up using it. Well, there's no metric to measure the peace of mind it might have provided to somebody who feared uncontrolled pain, who feared uncontrolled suffering, who got the prescription, but who had good hospice, good palliative care, and in the end didn't choose or need to use the prescription, but it gave them a peace of mind. We learned from Brittany Maynard, the young woman who left California, moved to Oregon in her mid to late 20s, diagnosed with brain cancer. She had surgery, radiation, chemo. It continued to be aggressive. Her doctor said, this will advance. She says, what can I expect? She said, you're gonna lose the ability to communicate, you'll lose control of bodily functions, you'll have unpredictable, uncontrolled convulsions. She wanted to have this option. When she moved to Oregon, and her husband and her mother were able to accompany her, not all Californians can do that, her mom said as soon as she got the prescription, there was a total change in her facing her end-of-life pathway. She said there was more levity, they cooked together, they hiked together, and 3 days before she ingested the medication, she spoke with Jerry Brown, Governor Jerry Brown, for about an hour. It was supposed to be a 10-minute phone conversation. He kept her on the line for about an hour. Her husband said it was actually tedious because she was very fatigued, and she wanted his commitment that he would sign a bill in California. And he wouldn't make that commitment in that phone call, even given the kind of intensity of this conversation and her courage to use her remaining days trying to expand this right to others and to establish it in California. He said, I can't in good faith make a commitment. There's not a bill on my desk, but I'll certainly keep an open mind. Her family describes gathering with her, holding hands, crying, laughing, sharing love for each other and goodbyes, and her going to sleep in a peaceful transition. Compare that to Jennifer Glass, 52 years old from San Mateo, who joined us as an active witness in our hearings in Sacramento. She also had terminal brain cancer, metastasized from lung cancer. Her husband and her sister were with her at her bedside. She had palliative care in California, was not a candidate at that time, the law hadn't passed, and kept coming out of the sedation, complaining that she felt as though she was drowning and asking for help, and died of starvation and dehydration about 6 days after the palliative sedation started. So her sister and her husband carry a very different memory of her passing than Brittany Maynard's family. And to me, those two experiences just contrast what we're talking about. I do want to focus more, fast forward, on the passage of the law. CMA was critical. We knew if CMA opposed it, they have a strong enough lobbying voice in Sacramento that we would probably not get it through the legislature. A lot of the legal terminology in the bill, we negotiated face-to-face with representatives of CMA. We met with their board of governors. We met with their legislative board. We also had active support from California Association of Family Physicians, which maintain neutrality, but for us, not having active opposition from physicians groups gave us the opportunity to have the conversation. When CMA, which had a historic in their bylaws opposition to what they called physician-assisted suicide, moved to reference of death with dignity or medically assisted death, and went from no to neutral. That allowed us to move forward in the legislature. We didn't know where Governor Brown would be. I'm sparing you some of the cul-de-sacs we hit in the legislative process, but we continued to push forward. We built a very strong alliance, and when we did clear it through both houses, Governor Brown had the final word. We knew from his staff that he had not come out with them saying he opposed it, nor had he said he would support it. So we were all left in this kind of guessing game. Compassion and Choices was a very strong ally throughout all of this, did a lot of grassroots organizing, and one of their doctor members in Oregon had worked in South Africa and had gotten to know Bishop Desmond Tutu. And Bishop Tutu sent a letter to Jerry Brown. I'm just going to read you, Jerry Brown's signing statement was ultimately very short, but he agonized over it. And a couple of the highlights, I've carefully read the thoughtful opposition materials presented by a number of doctors, religious leaders, and those who champion disability rights. I've considered the theological and religious perspectives that any deliberate shortening of one's life is sinful. I've also read the letters of those who support the bill, including heartfelt pleas from Brittany Maynard's family and Archbishop Desmond Tutu. He says, in the end, I was left to reflect on what I would want in the face of my own death. I do not know what I would do if I were dying in prolonged and excruciating pain. I'm certain, however, that it would be a comfort to be able to consider the options afforded by this bill, his final sentence, and I would not deny that right to others. So he signed this in October of 2015. Because we were in an extraordinary session, it didn't become law until June of this year. And since it has become law, we don't have good data yet. We will next year, because part of our bill requires the collection of data from physicians, and it'll be gathered by the Department of Public Health. But we've received notes from family members who, while grieving, having lost a loved one, have taken the time to send a note thanking us that their loved one was afforded this pathway for a compassionate transition, and how important it was to them and their family, and some sharing really descriptive accounts of the beauty of the participation of family members in that end-of-life process. I think it's important to point out, some people ask about insurance coverage. There's nothing in the bill that can mandate insurance coverage. The bill does make it a felony for an insurance company couldn't require that you do this. That would be a felony. They can't deny a procedure and say, no, we're not going to pay for that procedure because you could use this end-of-life option. We have felony prosecution for that, for any family member or physician or anyone in the process who coerces. And most of this bill's language is protecting against coercion. Those meetings with the two doctors 15 days apart, the doctor has to meet privately with the patient. So they can be accompanied by a family member, by an advocate, but there's going to be a one-on-one conversation. The only intrusion on that would be an interpreter, but that interpreter can't be a family member. So it's another way for the doctor to make his or her own assessment about the volitional nature. We've heard from people who say they have a family member suffering from Alzheimer's, or they may be in an early stage of Alzheimer's, and they just don't want to, once they don't recognize loved ones, they don't want to continue their journey on this planet. Why can't they use an advance directive? They make a very strong case, but this bill does not protect those people. You can't use an advance medical directive. You can't speak for somebody else. I know that this is what they would have wanted. So there's going to be a certain class of people who are terminal, but who would not qualify for consideration under the law. Since the law went into effect, there's been some legal challenges. As Catherine mentioned, some of the groups that opposed the bill along the way were anti-abortion, anti-choice organizations. They've filed a lawsuit in Riverside with an interesting legal theory. They're trying to get a superior court to mandate the district attorney to charge physicians who participate with homicide. And so you see kind of an overlap with the anti-choice forces trying to vilify physicians. That was ruled, the judge did not grant that extraordinary relief. It is now being appealed to the second appellate court. And I think in the interest of time, I will stop there. We expect the projections based on Oregon size and demographics, maybe somewhere in the area of 1,000 patients a year in California who would seek and qualify for the prescription. Again, I want to thank all of you for your interest, for the supporting organizations, for sponsoring this. I see many familiar faces around the room. Thank you all for being here, and I think we'll answer questions now. Great, thank you.
Thank you so much, Senator Monning. We really appreciate your updating us and putting it in the context of the history of the bill and where we are now. We have, I think, a little time to have some questions from the group for either of us. If you have questions, this is a good time.
Is it correct that since the death certificate will list the underlying illness as cause of death, then a person their families could get a life insurance benefit since it's not suicide?
That is correct. It's expressly protected and correct under the law.
It would be a felony to deny coverage under a life insurance policy.
Did everyone hear that? It would be a felony to deny life insurance coverage in that manner. It is the responsibility of the person signing the death certificate to correctly put the terminal cause of disease on the death certificate, and that's what's used for the determination of life insurance. That's correct. Other questions, thoughts?
This question is for Dr. Bernanke, actually. One of the main takeaways of being mortal is that what other cultures and countries do better than us here in end-of-life care. What does Dr. Gawande or say about his views or even his grandfather's views about where we're at with end-of-life in California in 2016?
Ooh. I'm not sure I can answer for him. I guess I'm curious to hear more about what's behind your question.
Okay, so full disclosure is I'm a primary care doctor. I'm also board certified in hospice and palliative care. Mm-hmm. I certainly appreciate in California with being exposed to many cultures. I did my residency in Merced, exposed to the Hmong population there, Southeast Asia, people of many cultures and countries. And what I've appreciated over the years is just how much better other cultures and countries do in end-of-life care. Mm-hmm. And my concern sometimes in end of life, and people don't want to suffer. That's the one thing I see is people don't want to suffer, mm-hmm. and suffering can come both physically and mentally and emotionally. Mm-hmm. And as a hospice doctor, I think this bill really challenges me to do a better job as a hospice doctor, mm-hmm. because I do feel that when patients are asking for this, I haven't done my job. Mm-hmm. But I also think that's what Gawande's grandfather would tell me. But that's just my own opinion.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think what I'm hearing you say is that we have been a death-denying culture for a long time. And I think with this bill and with a number of things with the Tools book, we are slowly, like at somewhat of a glacial pace, at least for me, shifting that and seeing that maybe that's not the best way to be, so.
I'd like to answer that question too, if you don't mind, as someone who also cares for a rich variety of patients from many cultures and many languages. And one of the things that I really have appreciated that we don't ask in our questions enough around death and dying is, what are your viewpoints on death and dying? And I think that it was brought up before that some people, it's not an appropriate conversation to actually have in the medical setting. And I think you're raising that as well. But one of the things that we have had, one of our palliative care and hospice doctors at Stanford just presented her first case where she was the one who was the prescribing physician. That's just the way that it was. And she had the same belief that if she did her job fantastically, that no one would want this, right? That's her job best done. No one would ever ask for this option. And actually, that in and itself is an implicit bias. That somehow, if you're the best ever at this thing that you've chosen to be your calling, that this option should never happen, right? But actually, that wasn't true, and it was exactly right for that person, and she felt really humbled by it. And she's really sort of thinking that through now. It's not for everyone, but it's for this person in the same way that someone came up with this question earlier. Is even the conversation right for every person? And the answer might be no. It might not be for everyone because it might be culturally inappropriate or this isn't the way we do that family or that culture does things. But I really appreciated her disclosure of that piece of it, like what can we learn about ourselves in opening ourselves to what are the options for somebody in practicing medicine in this amazingly diverse community of California today. So I really appreciate that question, and it is, we can't make assumptions about who someone might be even within their culture or their language or their family, but we also won't necessarily not provide an option to them, assuming from our base.
Just a quick comment on that question. It also raises the question of patient self-determination within a doctor-patient relationship, and I think all physicians aspire to provide the best end-of-life comfort and care and support and would hope that would be adequate. The Canadian Supreme Court just ruled that it's the government has no role. It's solely between patient and doctor, and recognizes the autonomy of a patient in confidential dialogue with his or her physician. We're very different here. In California, we're saying we're going to put in these protections to protect patients and physicians and make sure certain protocols are followed so there's not coercion. But I think the caring doctor who feels he or she is doing their job, if the person doesn't need to pursue this option, I'm sensitive to how Catherine framed that with her experience, because at a point here, it's who is the decision maker? Is it the physician or is it an informed patient? And I think that's part of the philosophical challenge that we're all gonna deal with.
Yes. Thank you. My understanding in terms of those organizations that opt out is that if you are a physician working in that organization on those premises, you can, as part of the overall discussion, let's say as an inpatient palliative care physician, say this is an option. But that if you choose to be a participating physician, you have to go off premises. You cannot be coerced into not having the relationship with the physician, with the patient. You simply cannot do it on the premises, like in the hospital or anything, any premises that are owned by that organization, correct?
That is correct. The law itself protects the organization from participating and can prohibit the employees from participating, but it cannot prohibit the employees from saying what's legal or possible. So if you think about what's true for other medical things that we do that fall into this classification, for instance, say vasectomy, can you tell a patient that vasectomy is legal and possible in your institution? Then this has the same protection. You wouldn't do the vasectomy in, for instance, perhaps, or you wouldn't, but you could say that it's possible. It's because it is. It's legal and possible. This institution isn't participating, but it's possible. Does that make sense?
You would then have to, by definition, refer that patient to some other physician who's not associated with that, who's not working within that.
Correct.
Okay. All right.
Or you could refer to the outside if you did. You had a private practice, but the law doesn't require you to refer. That's an individual decision.
Okay.
It also doesn't require you to have the conversation. Although many people might choose to talk about all options as an ethical decision under their relationship with their patient.